Hey, everyone. Welcome to this week's episode of the Amazon Files brought to you by Mommy Income. I am your host, Kristen Ostrander, and I have got a game changer for you for eBay sellers. And if you're not an eBay seller, don't worry. This is still pretty awesome. You guys have heard about fulfillment by Amazon, right? Right? Fulfillment by Amazon. How about fulfillment for eBay sellers? Imagine no more death piles in your corner and you've got things listed and you don't have to lose sales in order to find that. Well, guess what? We, our special guests today are Laurie and Dave, and they run a fulfillment center for eBay sellers. You guys, tune in. You are going to get excited about this, especially if you ever sold anything on eBay. If you don't love shipping and doing all that stuff yourself, oh my gosh, I can't wait for you guys to hear from Dave and Laurie. This is going to be awesome. But first, I want to make sure that you understand that Mommy Income is coming to a city near you, and we are going to do trade show walkthroughs and workshops and everything around the country. And so if you're in Michigan, if you're in LA, if you're in Minnesota, if you're in Florida, if you're in any of those places, I'm coming to a place near you, and there might even be more cities added the rest of this year. So make sure you go to mommyincome.com/workshop. The next one that's coming up is a trade show walkthrough event with a mini wholesale course included. So it's basically learning how to wholesale. If you're not ready for bundles yet, that's okay. You can just start getting into wholesale first. And I'm doing some trade show walkthroughs in Grand Rapids, Michigan, the end of February. You want to go to mommyincome.com/workshop and check that out, because I cannot wait to help you get started with wholesale. I love wholesale, and wholesale just makes life so much easier. It's not complicated. It's not scary. It's not hard. You can do it. It does not take a lot of just a little bit of learning. It's not a big learning curve to do wholesale. It really is easier than you think. So take a breath and be like, yes, I've got this. I can start wholesale. 2022 is going to be the year I'm going to start with wholesale. Yes, I'm talking right to you. And I want you to join me so I can help you with that and give you more confidence to be able to do wholesale in the great way. So mommyincome.com/workshop. Make sure you come see, check out a workshop, check out where I'm coming to a city near you. And if you have a request for me to come to a city near you, let me know. I'd be able, we'll see what I can do. So let's get to now my guests. So welcome, Dave and Laurie. I'm so glad that you guys are here. Welcome to the Amazon Files.
Thank you so much. We're happy to be here.
Mm-hmm. All right. So let's just dive right into this, right? Let's talk about, you know, of course, we can't reveal all the big secrets right away. So tell us a little bit about how you guys got started even in e-commerce and eBay.
Well, I think it's common. The way we started is similar to the way other people probably started, just selling little things out of your house, stumbling upon things that you could flip for a couple bucks. A friend of mine sells full-time on eBay, and I had no idea what it was all about. So I had him as a kind of like a mentor, and I found myself going to Goodwills and finding North Face jackets in Colorado for $4 at a Goodwill, and flipping them on eBay for, flipping them on eBay for like 50 or 60. And I was hooked. And that's when I realized this is a great side hustle to make some extra. I called it restaurant money, you know, like, hey, I made 150 bucks. Let's go out to a nice dinner. So that's how I got started. And then I saw the potential and just made it a full-time income for myself. And the rest is history. Laurie jumped on a couple of years later and we were off and running.
Okay. So since you said that, Laurie, I'm just going to ask you, like, so was this part of it when he first started getting to eBay? You're like, oh no, here we go again. Or was this something like, okay, let's see if this pans out before I jump in.
You know, I was working full time. I was completely happy with what I was doing, working from home. And he was doing this, he was having fun. He was, you know, getting all into it. I kind of let him be for a couple of years, and he actually, you know, with the business, meaning I didn't intervene or, you know, interfere, and he built it up to a really good predictable income. And so I saw that and I said, well, if this is just a numbers game, then what would happen if we doubled our efforts because I was there to help you source, list, ship. So that was our plan. You know, I quit my job. I actually went part-time with that job and part-time with Dave. And within a couple months, I realized I had to make a choice. I couldn't do both of them well part-time. And I said, which one has the better upside? I said, that Dave's job, definitely, you know, the eBay business definitely has a longer term upside. So I quit the job. I went with him full-time. I learned the entire business. And then we realized, well, we need to take this now to the next level. We need to hire people. So we hired a couple part-time listers and shippers so that we could fully source 100% of the time and really built our inventory up from when I think I started, you might've had 1200 listings.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We quickly almost tripled that in probably a year and a half or so.
Wow, y'all are like hardcore.
Yeah. We decided to just make it a full-time thing. And it was a little scary in the beginning because at the first, you know, I was like, is this really going to work? And is this really legitimate? But as we went along, you know, I'm kind of like the back end person. I like the numbers and trying to see like on paper, how does this look? So, you know, doing projections and trying to figure all this out, I'm like, yeah, there's no reason why this can't work. So we just kept going and kept going. And at our height, we had over 4,000 individually listed items on two accounts on eBay. And that's mostly comprised of one-off thrifted used electronics.
Mm-hmm. And during that time, just to share with you, the one thing that we didn't mention is we had to get more space. We couldn't work out of our house anymore because with that, you know, thousands of items, it takes over.
I was thinking either your house looks like an episode of Hoarders or you must have a warehouse.
Yeah, we definitely, I branched out. I got something that was $1,000 a month and it had heat and internet, which was huge. Otherwise it's a storage unit. So I was able to do that, but that commitment to space was another hurdle that people at resellers have in addition to hiring help. So that was a big commitment and a big investment.
Can we talk about the hiring help for just a moment? I know that that's something that tends to people, you know, that's a bottleneck for a lot of people. They're on the verge of this. And I loved what you guys said about like, you eventually had to make that choice, right? Of like, okay, you know, it reminds me of one of my favorite lines from Sweet Home Alabama. It's like, you can't ride two horses with one ass. So you have to figure out which one you're going to do. Right. And so that was like your transition to be like, wow, this is really working. And you know, when do we reach the side hustle versus full time? Right. So as you're making that transition, one of the things you said was hiring people. That's the next level of what can we do. If Dave can do this with just himself, what happens if I join? And then what happens if we hire employees? And so what did that process look like for you to be able to hire some people? Because I know that that's a big question a lot of eBay sellers have is like, how do I scale? I can't do this all by myself.
Correct. And that was a little bit of a time frame where we weren't sure how that was going to work out either. We originally were going to hire one person part-time. It was only about 20 hours a week. And literally they were going to list and ship. And then we actually hired two people 20 hours a week. So we actually hired a full-time person practically, but two of them. And so that we sourced full-time. So we were just able to get a lot of inventory very quickly. And they were able to list it all. And so we just, that's how we started with the employees, but I'll be honest, the whole managing of people is very daunting because it takes a certain kind of personality and skill set to be able to well manage other people well. You can't just be yourself sometimes, you know. You have to be a little bit more diplomatic. You have to really think about how your reactions or how you say things or what you say are going to, you know, be received by your employees. So, I mean, not only that, then there's a whole bunch of, you know, legal things and the payroll and all that sort of thing, added on to that. But it was definitely the best move we made because we wouldn't have been able to get all the inventory listed so quickly and grow the business to the point where, you know, now we can hire another person or whatever. So, it was necessary, but definitely, one of those, not sure how this is going to work out moments.
So when it comes to training an employee, we won't spend too much time on this because I know we've got bigger, better things to talk about. But when it comes to training, for example, I had hired one person one time to do some eBay listings for me, and I had a specific niche that I wanted her to work on. Although I have multiple thrifted items from all over the place, there was a specific niche that I was working in and gave her all the specs and all that stuff. And she has said she had done eBay listings before and all this stuff. And then she came and her listings were like, oh, these are not great. So is there any tools or software that you guys use and recommend to help your employees? Or is it really one of those like innate type things that like you either have it or you don't when it comes to writing listings?
Yeah, I would say this. It comes down to systems and processes. You need to know, you need to map this out for yourself and for anyone else that would want to come on board and help. One of the things that we developed was, we call them processing sheets. It's almost just like a cheat sheet where I will process items, electronic items, and write down works in it, blah, 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 the price. And I will copy the eBay, a comparable similar sell type of item off of eBay, and write that item number on the processing sheet. Put that in a bag with the processing sheet and hand it off to our listers. And it cuts down on the guesswork and it allows them to really streamline and list anywhere from 8 to 10 an hour once they get up to speed. And that includes photographs. So I really came up with that, but Laurie came up with a lot more.
Yeah, I would just add to that. Dave's absolutely correct with the processes and knowing it for yourself first. We chose to do manuals, like written instructions. I know a lot of other people will do videos, and we had that thought a long time ago. We never quite did it. But basically what I was hoping to do is be able to show, what we did was we showed them how to do it. And then we had this written manual so they could refer to it if they forgot a step or two. And so having that manual for shipping, for listing, for processing, for everything that we had to do was definitely something that we thought was very helpful. And I think everybody should have their processes in their brain written down.
Yeah. That is so, so key when you're hiring, is having that employee handbook or your, you know, key performance indicators for them, for you, your standard operating procedures. I know these are big corporate words. I was never in corporate, so I had to like learn all this stuff. I'm just like, it to me is just like like you said, a cheat sheet, a checklist of like, these are all the things that you need to do in order to kind of create a listing. Cause I think that's, besides what we're getting into next, which is fulfillment and shipment, of those things, is I think the biggest bottleneck for a lot of eBay sellers is they love the treasure hunt. They love the buying part. And then they have what I call the death piles, or the, you know, overflowing eBay closet where they loved to buy it and got it for a great deal, but then it's not being listed because that's the time consuming part. And then, oh, by the way, I have to ship that once it sells. I know when I was talking to you guys a few weeks back, that was like the thing that I had listed that finally sold. And then I went to go find it and then it wasn't there. So then I had to refund it because I'm not very organized. And you know what? That's why we need to talk about what happened when you guys got into this business and grew it so much, you started another business. So tell us about, like, this is like the big reveal, guys. I mean, you guys, I'm not really into big reveals, but this is, they do fulfillment for eBay. And that's why they're here talking to us, because I am so overwhelmed and blown away by what they do that everybody needed to hear about this. So tell us about eBliss and how you started eBliss and how this came about.
Okay, well, here's the big reveal. There is finally a fulfillment service for people that sell on eBay, Poshmark, Mercari, and it is eBliss. We came up with eBliss as an idea, a concept 3 years ago. I was thinking to myself, I said, this is unfair. I said, it's unfair for skilled thrifters, resellers, call it whatever you want, treasure hunters, value hunters, to be kind of plateauing because they have to deal with the mundane tasks like storage and shipping, which doesn't make money. That is not the revenue producing side of the business. So we came up with the idea of eBliss. It's similar to Amazon FBA, except we are not tied to what your sale price is. We don't take a percentage of that at all. What we allow people to do is we allow them to free up anywhere from 3 to 5 to 7 hours a week, because they no longer have to ship, and they use that time to source more and list more, and they get their death piles done. They get all that stuff listed and sent into our warehouse. And when it sells, we ship within the same or next business day. So it's a way to free up time and allow resellers to focus on the revenue producing side of their business, which is sourcing, which is good, which is not a problem. That is a skill. Resellers have that skill, and they should really just run with it and get the most that they can with it.
This is why I love what you guys do, because you saw a need in the marketplace, not only because you've been there and done that. And what you said is so absolutely true. Like reselling, thrifting, knowing, having an eye for what's out there and knowing you can flip stuff. I mean, I know, like, I want to go sourcing with you guys. Next time I go to like Denver, wherever you guys are in Colorado, I am literally, we're going to go sourcing together, because it's so fun to me to source with other resellers, because they have knowledge over here and I've got knowledge over here. And between that, like, we're all making, you know, a lot of money,
but
less we have to ship every single day, right? So you've created the need in this marketplace, because that's true. Like the money making task, the level of genius that a lot of sellers have is in that their eye for the thrift, the eye for the treasure, realizing this is going to make money. And that could just be a wealth of knowledge someone has about a specific category, or they could be like a freak of nature, which I've been called when it comes to thrifting. They're like, how did you know that that was going to make money without even looking it up? I'm like, years of experience, or just like my super spidey sense? Like, I don't know, but like, I see stuff and be like, that's weird. Someone's going to pay a lot of money for it. My husband's like, how do you do that? You just like have it. I'm like, I don't know, because weird stuff sells. And so I start looking up these things and like, oh my gosh, this is worth $500. Who knew that? It's like this little, you know, whatever. Anyway, that's definitely a weird skill that some of us can have. But the thing is, that's what makes us money. But shipping and storage and all of that jazz is not really what's making us money. So walk us through this process, right? Because now everybody is like, oh, let me in. But like, tell us a little bit about this process, because I'm sure it's not for every seller. I'm sure there's some restrictions and some processes that we have to go through to get to the fulfillment and things. So break down the process of eBay fulfillment for us.
Sure. Well, actually, just a side note, when we first launched eBliss, it was only for eBayers. You had to sell on eBay in order to use us. We have since been able to branch that out to now you have to sell on eBay and or Poshmark. So it doesn't have to be one or the other. It can be one or the other. So it's not just eBayers. So it's Poshmark and any of the other smaller platforms. So if you'd want to use us, basically we use Poshmark or eBay as a primary platform for receiving your items into our warehouse. So we utilize either the SKU field or the custom label in eBay. And so we have SKU stickers that we provide. We provide actually the boxes and the bags that we use and the stickers. So essentially the sticker number equates to the listing. So whether you're on eBay or Poshmark, and the processes are slightly different, but you put that number in the SKU or the custom label so that we know that this bag with that sticker on it is this listing. So that when we put our location of that item in our warehouse, when it sells, we know where to find it and we can fulfill it for you. And we based our eBliss processes, basically most of them, all of them, on our regular eBay business, which was working really well for us. Our 4,000 items, you know, we could find them, we ship them, no problem. So we modeled eBliss after that idea, because at the time, there was honestly no fulfillment service, and I think there still isn't, that caters to this kind of reseller. The reseller who buys one-off used thrifted items of many sorts, whether it's clothes, books, games, electronics. It runs the gamut. Now, we do have a size and weight limitation for our items, because we do have limited space in our warehouse too. But it is up to the items need to fit at least in a 14 by 20 size bag, which is pretty significant. You can fit a lot of good things in there. And it has to weigh less than 6 pounds. So, and the reason for that is we are paying primarily for all the inbound UPS shipping. So we had to kind of cap that a little bit.
Wait, you pay for shipping too?
Correct. We pay for the inbound.
When I send stuff to you, you pay for the shipping?
For the most part. It depends on which plan you're on, but yes,
that's insane.
With some restrictions, correct. So it makes it really easy. We actually have you set up with UPS. They will come to your house if you want and pick it up, or you can drop it off at any UPS location. So it's super convenient to get the items to us. And then once we get them, we will turn them around within 2 business days. And once they sell, we check your eBay and your Poshmark accounts each morning for shipping. All the other platforms, you just have to send us the labels with the SKU information, and then we can fulfill them. So it's working out really well. I think our clients really appreciate the time they save, the fact that they can scale without worrying about cluttering up their own home. Let's be honest, everybody has some space limitations at some point. So when Dave was talking about the plateauing of your business, a lot of times the space is the issue. You know, you can source so many things, but where are you going to put them? So that alleviates that bottleneck for a lot of resellers.
Yeah. And we'll be honest too, with eBay stuff, like, especially, I know that not everybody's like this, but you guys are, so you understand, speak the language, right? Like, you thrift something, like, say it's like, and I know Christmas stuff sells year round because I have experience with that, but like, sometimes you source a Christmas item in February at like an estate sale. And usually people aren't really buying those kinds of things in this time of year. And you're going to have to store that till Christmas. And what happens is, what happened to me is, it like, oh, I, you know, this great department 56, you know, house or whatever that I found for, you know, $3 at a yard sale or something. And then it goes into the closet. I call it the closet, mm-hmm. the one that's overflowing with all of my eBay things. And it kind of stays in there. And then I create the listing and it's all there. But then all of a sudden it's like December 10th and I'm out doing some fun December 10th thing. And this thing sells on eBay. And I'm like, oh, now I have to dig that out of the closet, find it, ship it, and hope it didn't get lost or broken in the meantime. So you guys kind of prevent all that. You can actually list your stuff and then just kind of forget it, like you do with Amazon FBA. And I know a lot of our people have both eBay and Amazon stores. Some of them are on all of the platforms selling different places. And this was like the one missing link for eBay, which is kind of why it's mm-hmm. gone downhill a little bit for a lot of people, because that is the actual bottleneck. And guess what I love? I love location freedom. So I am going to eventually be a snowbird. Right now we have children, so we can't exactly fly around the country whenever we want to. But with my business, I can. I'm not stuck here waiting to ship something. And that's what awesome. This is bringing to the table, is more freedom to be able to say, hey, I can still sell on eBay without having to be home to fish out and ship all these things out.
That is incredible. And that is the one word that we love to use when describing eBliss, is freedom. Mm-hmm. It's freedom to scale and grow your business. It's freedom to do the components of reselling that you like. And it's also the freedom to travel and not have to put your store on time away. We have a few clients, one in particular right now is like traveling the world. And when he's in the US, like, he'll send in stuff to us. And it's just hearing those stories really is rewarding to us. That's what we want. We love to restore the joy in reselling to all of our clients.
Well, I think you guys are doing a great job with that. Okay. So you talked about some of the limitations, which is, you know, of course, you know, as your business grows, you might open that up for discussion or things like that. I would ask like the weird questions that I know I always get from clients. It'll be like, so if I live in the area, can I just drop this stuff off? And does it still apply to your weight limits and size limits if I can bring it to you? And I know resellers too, that travel the country and they go to different sales and different estate sales or liquidations. And then they, like, I have a, I'm not sure if you heard of the Bearded Picker, yes. Scott Zilke, dude, I love him, and I are friends. We go way back, and he's great. And that's what he's done for many years, is he'll go around doing both Amazon FBA and eBay, going around from different places. He'll be in Colorado, then he'll be in Alabama, then he'll be up here in Michigan, and he's going all of these places. And he actually does his shipping in transit. So he'll come home, he'll be at a hotel, he'll process all of his shipments for FBA, send those in. And I'm like, well, what do you do about your eBay stuff? He goes, well, I bring all that home and then I put it in my warehouse and this and that. I'm like, man, he needs you guys so that he can start sending stuff in there and he can just make more money as he's going on. And say, well, he processes his Amazon FBA in his hotel. He could process the same with his eBay listings for you guys and ship them both out. And now he's hands-free and doesn't even have to bring a trailer anymore.
Yeah, totally. And I watch a Pure Hustle podcast with Orlando, and he does the same thing with Amazon FBA. But there are certain things that he keeps to list on eBay because he can't send it into Amazon. So yeah, those items would be sent into us, just like they're sending things into Amazon FBA. They would send them into us. We still have to adhere to now you were saying if they're in the area, it's like, let me dump off this desk or let me jump off this chair. Yeah. We might have to have a conversation, but
hey, I was just grasping at straws here.
I know.
We do actually have some local clients. Yeah. We have a small handful of local clients. And I can say when it comes to their items, there's a little bit of leeway, but not a lot. It's like you said, Dave, we're not going to be, our warehouse is not set up to be storing very large items.
Yeah. So let's talk about the items that kind of qualify for your program. I know that there's some price limitations because you guys have like a flat rate fee. Is that how it works? And how, like, you know, like if people are selling like $10 items, it's probably not conducive. So where is that limit where people start and how they can kind of grow with you?
Well, that really depends on their COGS. It really depends on what they're getting their items for. And everybody has to choose for themselves what makes sense for their own business. Some clients choose to go volume. And so they're not making that much on each item, but they're selling a lot of them. So it actually works out for them. But generally speaking, because of the way our pricing structure works, we say that it's about $25 is probably the minimum that would probably make sense for most people, considering fees and shipping costs and COGS.
And we structured our pricing, unlike Amazon FBA that takes a percentage of the final value, we structured it to allow our clients, the resellers, to have the freedom to make that decision whether they want to store a long tail item. We don't have spikes in storage like Amazon FBA. We're not going to gate people from selling anything. So it allows them, it puts them, our pricing structure, as Laurie will probably get into, it typically is around, call it $5 an item from start to finish, all in for our clients. So if somebody, for example, is out thrifting and they find something that they could sell for $100, but it may take a year to sell and they're getting it for 10, they're like, yeah, I'll pay $5, $6, $7 all in, it's worth it. So our pricing structure is simple. So people use that when they're in the field sourcing. So they factor in like, well, eBay's going to take this, eBliss was going to take this, so they could figure out what their profit is. Right. It's not a guess.
I love that because I don't know how many tools and different things people use for the apps and like what's it worth and stuff like that on eBay. And, you know, of course with the completed listings and everything, but I'm always factoring that in too. Is it like, where am I going to put this? How much bubble wrap am I going to need to sell this, you know, stuff like that, to where it's like, you get so caught up with all that stuff. That it's like, sometimes it's just forget it, you know? So making the money. So $25 is about the minimum, depending, you know, some people are getting stuff for like pennies on the dollar. So if they're selling it for 15 or 20 bucks plus your $5 fee, they're still making a killing, then that still qualifies. But that's a good benchmark to kind of, you know, gauge.
Yeah. Basically the higher your ASP, average selling price of your items, the less our service is going to cost you as a percentage of your overall sales. That's basically the way it works, because our pricing, depending on the plan you're on, is sort of flat depending on the activity. So that's why we say, if you've got an average selling price, your items, you're selling your stuff for $40, $50. I mean, our fee is not going to be that much comparatively speaking than if you're selling your items are $20 to $25.
Right. I totally hear you there. I'm a vintage jewelry collector, buy, sell, trade kind of person. And I get a lot of lots where I'll go in on like the last day of an estate sale and I'll be like, how much for every piece of jewelry, sight unseen? Like, I know it's all, you know, it's not like, I'm not selling like real gemstones and like, you know, real gold and stuff. I want all the fake stuff because A, I make projects with it, and B, I resell it on eBay. And sometimes I lot the bad stuff and just sell it like, okay, $30 for this 5-pound box of junk jewelry, because I've already cherry picked out the $100 sets that they have in there. Right. So, you know, I do it that way. And that would be a great way to just be like selling the grab bag of jewelry that just like, you know, those sell regularly at, you know, $30 each, sending those to you guys. And I don't even have to categorize or worry about it. I just be like, oh, this is going to be so great. You guys, just as a disclaimer, I have not yet tried this. I know that most of the things that I talk about, it's because mostly I don't have my stuff together. eBay is like my side hustle. I already run two businesses, let alone with my eBay, but this is going to make it, basically I'm going to resurrect the eBay business that I have because of you guys. And now I know that I can have the location freedom that I want to not have to ship those things. That's going to kind of resurrect that. So stay tuned, guys, because there will be an update about this once I get started and start selling more on eBay because of eBliss. So what else do we need to know about this eBay fulfillment? Because I hear some other questions that I know people are going to ask, like, okay, well, do you have storage fees and how long? You talked about the long tail item there. So it's February right now, and I'm going to, I bought some Christmas items. That's one of the reasons I use that as an example, because I'm always estate sailing on weekends. It's like my fun time. And then I buy stuff and then it sits there. And so with my Christmas stuff, if I'm sending that in next month, and you know, is there a certain storage fee that we're going to have to pay for these long tail items?
No, everything is upfront. There's no, as I mentioned earlier, there's no, spike in storage or escalated storage. we're all about, since we are resellers, we understand that there's value in long tail items. When you're buying something $10, $15, $20, and you could sell it for $200, but it may take 2 years, why should you say no? You know, get it up, get it listed, get it out of your house, get it into a warehouse. And something like that, if it stayed with us for 2 years, it probably all in would maybe run $12 to $15.
For the storage.
So you may say like, that's worth it. And as far as fulfillment, you know, back to your what you were talking about, when we expanded and hired employees and got the space, we had to pretty much, you know, I always use the phrase, bite off more than we could chew, because we had to get more space than we needed so we could grow into it. We love the fact that we deal with all type of clients, those that just want the items out of their house and don't plan on growing, and those that want to grow. And we have the ability to accommodate them if they wanted to scale. So there's no commitment. There's no like, hey, Dave and Lori, you know, I don't plan on growing my business, but if I do, are you going to penalize me? Not at all. So the flexibility is there for all of our clients. And that's why we like to let you know, like we like to speak to everyone prior to signing on with us, because we are resellers. We want to hear about their goals, their objectives. And if we're a great fit, awesome. If not, not a problem. And we just want to get the word out there to allow people to get the freedom back in their reselling business. That's our main goal.
That is so awesome that you guys are doing that. Okay, so here's another one of the devil's advocate right here, because I want to make sure that our listeners have no questions. Of course, they're going to have some questions, but they're going to be like ready to be all in on this, because, you know, this is such an important thing. I tend to be a little, I'm just going to throw myself under the bus here. I tend to be a little sloppy when writing some of my listings on eBay. So okay. What happens if Kristen makes a mistake on a listing and someone asks about that and they're like, can we get an additional picture of the backside, or can we get like a little bit of a measurement, or, you know, can I see that stain up close, whatever it is? Like, is there a way you guys can handle that? Because that seems like a lot of extra work.
Yes, we do allow for inquiries, as we call them. If you've missed a weird, you know, measurement here or there, or weird angle on your photos, or if you just overlook something, sure, you know, you just email us, give us the SKU information, we'll go pull it and oblige to that request. Now, of course, it's not meant to be a replacement for good listings. So if it becomes an issue, obviously we're going to have a conversation. You can't expect us to be taking measurements for every single thing that you're sending in because you didn't want to do it. That's not right. What we're doing. Okay. So yeah, you still, and that's the thing. Like, our focus is on actual resellers. Because that's who we were when we first started this. And so we wanted to be able to provide this service for resellers. We're not really interested in housing people's items who just want to source and they don't want to do the work of actually being a reseller. So that's why it's called Reseller Solutions, because we feel like we are a solution for a lot of these issues that resellers have, not the casual thrifter, flipper. You know, there's other places, if you want to make money doing that, there are other options for you there. So that's why, yeah, sure, we will pull that item and take that picture, but it's not meant to be a replacement for poor listings.
Right, and each of our clients is assigned an account manager. We have an account manager that could manage upwards of 50 accounts. So, you know, it's a quick email, and, you know, we'll get back
by the next business day. That's our turnaround on that.
That is so awesome. Right. So another question. Oh, this is so great. This makes me more and more excited the more I talk to you guys about this stuff, because this is such a needed thing in this world to be able to grow and scale. Most people, again, they reach that plateau, that ceiling of I can only house so many things, or now you're into a storage shed. I've even seen people buy and rent those like pods that go out and outside. So it's like your storage unit, yet it's on your property. Those are hundreds of dollars a month, but people are just like so expanding into those things. Because we all know that like the long tail items, things don't always sell through immediately. You've always got those immediate flips that you can kind of do, but then there's those most items are long tail. You know, you're selling things every day because you listed those things 3 months ago, 6 months ago, last week. But, you know, as you're continuing to grow that, you can kind of build up to that. So is there like a minimum, like people have to send you 20 items to begin with, or can they start really small?
Well, it actually depends on the plan that you're on. We have two plans. When we first launched, we just basically had what we call the freedom plan. And the idea was that you send us most, if not all, of your listed inventory at that time. And that could be anywhere from 200 to 1,000 items, depending on what you have. And so that is a little bit daunting for some people to, you know, just especially those who aren't familiar with fulfillment. They're not familiar with us. So that worked for some people and that's been working great. But then for other people, we said, you know what if you just wanted to send us a few things a month just to get your feet wet, to feel how fulfillment feels, to get to know our policies, this, that, and the other thing. So we launched the startup plan. So that one, you only have to send us 200 things. Sorry, I'm getting them confused. 20 items a month. So it's a really small investment. On the freedom plan, you have to start out with 200 and keep 200. So it depends on what your goals are. It depends on how your comfort level of you know, working with us and having somebody else ship for you, because that was always a big thing in the beginning. People were like, well, I don't know if anybody can do this better than me. So it's, you know, a way to just try it out. And you know what, if it doesn't work for you, no problem at all. We're not going to expect that you're going to keep going with it if it's not working for you.
Right. For sure. So you have it on a consistent basis. So the startup plan is 20 items per month. So you're wanting that, you know, kind of consistent, you know, sending in of items. Do you also fulfill, I know you mentioned Poshmark and eBay. I know Mercari is one of those and they get complicated because I'm a Mercari seller and I know that they require you to print your stuff. And you mentioned that we send those via email to you. But what about say like Facebook Marketplace? I know that sometimes a Facebook Marketplace, it's not attached to a specific listing, but people cross list both on Poshmark, Mercari, eBay, Etsy, places like that. So do you fulfill for Etsy and Facebook Marketplace too?
As long as you can send us that label with the SKU information, if it's in our warehouse, we don't really care where it was sold.
Right.
Now, of course, you're responsible for taking it down on any of those other platforms. But yeah, it does
list perfectly.
Yes, absolutely. And as a matter of fact, we're in the beta testing process right now of using List Perfectly and Vendu as receiving platforms, which would actually help our cross-listers immensely because the process right now is a little, depending on where you start your listings, can be a little, you know, a couple more steps. So we're trying to simplify that and make it easier for our clients to send us items in via those platforms.
That is awesome. I love when everybody, you guys are just innovators. You're like ready to solve the next problem before people even ask the questions. And that's what I love about what you guys are doing. I've kind of watched you evolve a little bit over the past 3 or 4 months, just even on social media. And that's just really been awesome. And just to see, you're just a powerhouse ready to serve people. And that's why I love just what you're doing, because at every turn, you're like, oh, we've got that in the works. Oh, we've got that. You guys just know what's going on. And I love that. So let's be real though. Everything's not all sunshines and rainbows, right? So let's talk a little bit about like some of the pitfalls and some of the things where it's like, oh, we really kind of didn't know what we didn't know there, and how you kind of worked out some of that. So what have been a couple of challenges for you guys that you've had to kind of work through in order to get where you are today?
Thinking back, our concept, and I'll spill the beans right here. We wanted to list, take photos, and store and ship.
That's what the L stood for.
Yeah,
stood for was, in list in eBliss.
eBliss was an acronym for eBay listing, inventory, storage, and shipping.
Right.
And then we realized during our beta testing that we cannot list for people. We can't take what's in their mind and transfer that into a listing. There's too much value lost or potential to be lost. And during our beta testing, we realized, you know what? No, let's listen to what the reselling community wants and needs, and we will adapt to that. So there hasn't been a ton of pitfalls. And I think that's because we are being very deliberate in how we are growing this. And we're listening to our clients. We're listening to even non-clients that come to us and be like, this would be great if you could do this. I'll share something with you. We have a client in Canada that sells on eBay.com. This client would use a cross what is it called?
Cross-border shipper.
Yeah.
And just to be full disclosure, it's still in the beta phase, the Canadian.
Very close to.
Yeah. We're working on expanding or launching our Canadian division or whatever you want to call it.
Right. And she was like, can you work with me? Because I'm using this cross-border shipper. It's costing me a lot. Is there any way I get all my items to you guys located in Denver and have you guys ship within the US? And Laurie and I are two different personalities. I'm like, yes, we can. And Laurie's like, no, we can't.
I didn't say no, we can't. I said, let's figure out how to do this first.
So I see what comes to us and I'm like, yes, let's do it. And then we methodically go through it to make sure the systems and processes can work and are in place. So as far as, you know, pitfalls or disasters or anything like that, I really can't think of any.
Well, I can just name one thing that happened that surprised us. Poshmark kind of threw us a loop when they changed the way they showed the SKU on the orders field. I mean, this is very nitty gritty. I'll just give you this example. They changed the way they showed the SKU on their orders so that our EB sticker number was no longer showing. Oh. And we're like, how are we going to find these items now? So we had to adapt. And we had to, you know, figure out a different way of entering that information so that now when we go into the Poshmark orders, we can see where the items are. So that was one kind of like, threw us for a loop there.
Yeah, snafu, but that's business. You have to adapt, whether you're a reseller or someone like us with eBliss, you have to adapt and it's okay to adapt.
So let's just like, if I'm going to bring this all back into like a 1 minute summary of what we're doing. So just yes or no here, like I'm an eBay seller. And if I list and picture and take images and create my listings best I can, and I literally send all of that stuff to you guys, then I can literally go and sit on the beach and not worry about any of that. And you guys, you check the orders. I don't have to send you emails every day. You just like things get sold and I'm, you know, sitting on the beach, drinking a lovely cocktail and you guys are just shipping all the stuff and everything's going awesome.
That is correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, where do I sign? That's what everybody should be saying right now. That's an eBay seller. I love the fact that you guys were really ambitious in the beginning about the listing and the image creation and things like that. But I'm with you on that because that was the one thing I tried to outsource first was actually the listing creation and realized that I still had to do the bulk of the listing creation because my employee doesn't have the knowledge in my head about that item. And so that's really, eventually we'll all crack the code and get somebody to say this, right?
I always share this, the reselling business, I break it down into three categories. There's the sourcing, there's the listing, and then there's the storage and shipping. Mm-hmm. Selfish reasons, I suggest you outsource, if anything, you outsource the back end of that first, which is the storage and the shipping, because there's no money to be made in there. The listing, as I mentioned earlier, there's value to be added. So the outsourcing the storage and the shipping frees up so much more time. And real quick, one of our clients that signed up says, I'm saving 5 hours a week by not having to pick, pack, and take my stuff to USPS. I'm using those 5 hours to go source. And I asked her, I said, well, how much dollar value can you source per hour? And she goes, oh, 150, 200. So she goes, I'm essentially making $1,000 extra a week, $4,000 a month by sourcing more. So that's where the value is.
Absolutely. I've always been an advocate for time is money. And no matter if you're Dave and Laurie or myself or Oprah or the president or whoever, 168 hours a week, that's it. You cannot increase that unless you outsource things like that, non-money making tasks. And, you know, it's funny, I already told you guys how aligned we were in this, but I love how you brought that up too, because like all my regular listeners know, like time is money. What are you doing with that hour? Are you doing, you know, minimum wage tasks? And when your value is actually probably in the lawyer range of how much you get paid, as far as that, use your time to the best of your ability, which would be in the sourcing. And even though people don't like it, even though I don't like it, the listing is where you make the money. So that is where you need to spend the most time. Sure. And again, outsourcing all the stuff that, like, yeah, we're not making money on shipping. We're not making money putting box on, you know, tape on boxes and things. And I even tell that to people with, I'm such an advocate for prep centers for Amazon FBA, because before, again, same thing as you, we knocked out a wall in our house and had an extra room for Amazon FBA prep because that was our full-time, that's our full-time business. But we realized that after that was a bottleneck after we grew, because we grew into that space and then we had more time to grow into. And we're like, we're not building an addition on our house. And we did not want a full warehouse with full employees. And all. That's not something I wanted to get into. We have remote team members and we did have payroll and all that stuff, but I didn't want to think, if this warehouse worker doesn't show up today, guess who has to do it? But right. When you have a prep center or an eBliss or a team that helps you, then if it, that's not my problem. And that's the greatest thing about being a reseller or being somewhere in this position, is that if your warehouse workers don't show up today, y'all are rolling up your sleeves, not me. Right. So
that is true. You know,
that's that part is of true. Having that. But that also gives me the freedom to be able to source more and list more, because I'm not worrying about whether or not someone's going to get COVID in my warehouse and I can't like produce that. So first of all, thank you for taking on that kind of responsibility for the rest of us. But also to the people that are like, well, I'm just not sure about these things. The time versus money is so important. You're not making money on storage and shipment.
Right. And the one thing I wanted to point out too, is a lot of people overlook, is that you can't write off your own time that you're doing this yourself on your taxes. Right. But if you outsource it, that is an expense that you can write off. So you're actually even saving money even more by having somebody else do it.
Absolutely. That is so true and so crazy. So again, you guys, in order to just talk to, even they're worth a phone call, even if you know, don't go with them, they're still really cool people. So give them a call or you know, check out their website. That you can find everything that you need about eBliss reseller at mommyincome.com/eBliss. Here is also your code word for the week. If you want to join the Mommy Income Facebook group and get more information from Laurie and Dave and just more information about reselling, about Amazon, about all these things, mommyincome.com/join us. You need your code word, of course, it's #eBliss, and you can also find them, eBliss Reseller, on Instagram. You guys, you gotta follow them on Instagram. They crack me up. They're funny. They make funny videos and cool stuff.
That's
and,
all him.
I know. Dave cracks me up all the time. Lori's like, no, don't put me on there. No, I'm just kidding. You guys are amazing. And also on Facebook, of course, do you guys have like a Facebook group or anything like that that you're regularly doing, or is it just
not at this time. Yeah. No, but we're on YouTube. We're on YouTube though. We do a YouTube live every Wednesday at 1 Mountain Time. So you can join us there. You can watch the previous ones. So
absolutely. YouTube, everywhere else. And of course, if you guys want to learn more about that, we do have an affiliate link for you, because we always have affiliate links because, you know, doing all this stuff costs money. Did you know that? And so, yeah, I'm unashamed about talking about my affiliate links because, you know, I get a few kickbacks from amazing people like yourselves when I refer business. So mommyincome.com/eBliss, that's going to get you everything you need, get you started, get you a phone call with them, get you, you know, I don't know, breakfast and a dinner and a movie. No, I'm just kidding. but yeah, anything that you went out there. Also, their website is eblissreseller.com. Make sure you visit them there. All the links are going to be below this video and in the show notes for all of you listeners. Any last and final words you have? What did we miss? What did we skip?
Well, I'm sure we skipped some nitty-gritty things, the details, but the overall idea is, you know what? Like you said, it's worth a phone call. We just want to talk to you about your business, see if this might work. It may not work now. It might work later. We could give you tips and things that might make it so that it would work. But we just love to talk to resellers. I don't know if we mentioned that we run the Denver eBay meetup group out here. So we're constantly, you know, in touch with other resellers, and we feel, you're right, like, we like to serve other resellers and help them with their businesses.
Yeah, we just have a passion for it. Reselling is our first entrepreneurial experience ever. And it's been the most fulfilling experience in my life. Fulfilling, no pun intended, fulfillment. But
took the words out of my mouth. That was like, should I mention the pun?
Boom, boom, boom. Yeah. But honestly, the joy that Lori had working together, being full-time resellers, even part-time, the joy that you get from reselling sometimes is lost when you're filling it with mundane, time-sucking activities. And we're all about promoting freedom and joy. So we want to restore the joy in reselling and allow and taking that nonsense from people's tasks, daily tasks. So reach out to us, DM us. We love talking to resellers, and let's have fun. Let's help each other out there in the community.
Yeah, absolutely. And I love how that ties right into your name as well, eBliss, instead of it being like a pain in the neck, because we're like, oh yeah, we have a love-hate relationship with our resale business. Now it can be more of that joy and that bliss that you're talking about, yeah. Because that really is, you know, if I know, instead of shipping and storing and organizing and figuring out all where the stuff is and gathering my bubble wrap and my supplies and which boxes this thing fit in, I can be out there sourcing and looking for more deals, because we know that's also where the joy comes from, right? It's the score. It's like, look at, I just, last week we went to, it's actually not too long ago, it was this past weekend, my husband and I went to this estate sale, and it was kind of the final days, leftover stuff, and we found these really old NFL pennants that like the pennant flags from like 20 years ago. And so they're all old logos. And we started, you know, looking them up on eBay. I'm like, oh my gosh, what a score here. And so, you know, even things like that. But again, they're sitting over here unlisted, because I'm like, what am I going to do with this? So that really gets the fire under you when you know you can send in 20 items a month and list them. Maybe it's a half of an afternoon. It won't take me that long to list those things now that I know that I can list them and then get them out of my hair and just continue the sourcing. Because that's really what reselling is about. Is making that money, having that experience of not only our own, like you said, fulfillment, because that's really what it is. It's like, oh, I scored today. And it's like winning. It's like winning a game. It's like, I don't know, something cool about it.
Love it. So true.
All right, you guys. Well, thank you so much for joining us on the Amazon Files. You guys, I know you could be anywhere else listening to any other thing, watching any other thing. I don't take that for granted. Thank you for listening to the Amazon Files. We'll see you same time, same place next week.